Amen. Tonight I am finishing my sermon from this morning where I was preaching against this wicked book, The Shack. And the reason I'm preaching against this book is because right on the cover it says that over 20 million copies have sold. But not only that, right now in theaters there's a movie out that's basically the same as this book from what I can tell, from what I read online. And Christians, quote unquote, are by the droves going to see this movie, and it's just changing their life, and they love it so much, and on and on. And there's a great falling away that's happening right now. I mean, who would have thought, even when I was a child, and I'm a young man, that mainstream evangelical Christianity would flock to go see a movie where God is depicted as a woman and get excited about a book where God's depicted as a woman? You know, even when I was a teenager, there was a pop song that came out that said, "Tell me all your thoughts on God because I'd really like to meet her." You remember that song being on the radio all the time, if those that are in my generation? At the time, even the most liberal neo-evangelical churches would preach against that and say that that was bad and that God's not a woman. But today, it's just accepted. It's normal. The movie's only been in theaters for a couple weeks. It's already brought in like around $43-45 million dollars at the box office. It's a big blockbuster. In fact, we were out to lunch this afternoon and we were right by a theater, so we walked over and looked, and sure enough, it was playing multiple times. It's probably at every theater in America. But not only that, even preachers are endorsing this. They advertise in the movie that 1,000 faith leaders have endorsed it. But even Kent Hovind, independent fundamental Baptist pastor, or not pastor, but preacher, evangelist, has endorsed this and said that it's one of his favorite books. He's read it 9 times and on and on. So this book is really corrupting a lot of people, and we need to talk about this, and we need to show what the Bible actually teaches. Now, I'm just going to give a super fast review of this morning because I don't want to get too bogged down in that. I have so much material for tonight. But number one, the problem with this book was that it depicted God the Father as a large black woman named Papa. The Holy Spirit was depicted as a Chinese woman who had the name of a Hindu goddess. Number three, the book taught that God the Father does not have any authority over Jesus. We showed very clearly in the Bible that Jesus is subject unto the Father. Even after the millennium, Jesus is subject unto the Father. Number four, it teaches that Jesus' life is not to be an example unto us. Number five, it teaches that every person is a child of God. And number six, it teaches that God will not condemn anyone to hell. So right there, that's a lot of bad doctrine. Oh, but wait, there's more, okay? There's a lot more. And so tonight, I'm preaching about all the rest of the heresies that are in this book. Now, first of all, you're there in Acts chapter 14. The seventh thing that I want to show you about this book is that this book basically teaches you that church is bad. Now, that's the message that comes across very strongly in this book, is that church is bad. And when the author is called on the carpet about this, he says, "Oh, no, 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 I love the church. I love the bride of Christ." But when he says that, he doesn't mean what we mean when we say church. When he says the church, he's talking about this invisible, universal church made up of all believers. He's not talking about what the Bible defines as the church, the local assembly of believers, the local congregation of God's people, which it's clear in this book that he hates the church. So because he attributes all his opinions to deity, in this book, God despises the church and makes light of the church and so forth. But let's see what the Bible defines as the church. Look at Acts 14, verse 23. "And when they had ordained them elders in every church." Now stop right there. If the church is just made up of all believers everywhere, then how can you have the word every church? How can you have churches? The word churches, plural, is used scores of times in the Bible, proving that there's not one universal church, but rather there are churches. The church at Ephesus, the church at Smyrna, the church at Pergamos, the church at Thyatira. All these different local churches with various geographies associated with them. Every church. "They ordained elders in every church and had prayed with fasting. They commended them to the Lord on whom they believed." Look at verse 27. "And when they were come and had gathered the church together, they rehearsed all that God had done with them. and how he had opened the door of faith unto the Gentiles. Let me ask you this. How can you gather the church together if the church consists of all believers everywhere? That doesn't make any sense, does it? Go to Acts chapter 20. Acts chapter 20. While you're turning there, I'm going to begin to read for you from this book, The Shack, that Christians are just eating up today because there's a great falling away going on. You're talking about the church as this woman you're in love with. This is what the main character is saying to Jesus in the book. You're talking about the church as this woman you're in love with. I'm pretty sure I haven't met her. He turned away slightly. She's not the place I go on Sundays. Well, get in the right church, buddy. Right. Mac said more to himself than to Jesus, unsure if that was safe to say out loud. Mac, that's because you're only seeing the institution, a man-made system. That's not what I came to build. What I see are people and their lives, a living, breathing community of all those who love me, not buildings and programs. Mac was a bit taken aback to hear Jesus talking about the church this way. But then again, it didn't really surprise him. It was a relief. So how do I become part of that church, he asked, the woman that you seem to be so gaga over? It's simple, Mac. It's all about relationships and simply sharing life. What we're doing right now. And by the way, they're hanging out at a lake right now. They're hanging out at a lake, throwing rocks in the water. Man, it's what we're doing right now. Just doing this. Just being open and available to others around us. That's the church, man. You gotta free yourself from these institutions, man. It's all man-made. We're doing church right now, man. Just being in nature. Just being open. Just being available. This is garbage. The Bible says that Christ ordained the church. Christ built the church. And if he said ordain elders in every church, he's not saying, hey, let's ordain people at every campground, every lake, every park. He's saying ordain elders in the church. What are elders? Leaders. The Bible says let the elders that rule well be counted worthy of double honor. This guy says no one should be in charge, no ruler, no elder, no boss. That's all a man-made structure. No, it's not. It's a God-ordained institution, the local church. But he just scoffs at it and says, we're in church, man. We're at the lake. For Mac, these words were like a breath of fresh air. Simple, not a bunch of exhausting work and a long list of demands. And not sitting in endless meetings staring at the backs of people's heads. People he really didn't even know. Just sharing life. Now let me ask you this. Why do you think this book is so popular? Why do you think there's 20 million copies sold? Why do you think people are watching it right now at the theater a few miles from here? I'll tell you why. Because it's like a breath of fresh air to them for somebody to tell them, you don't have to go to church. Just go camping. Just go outside. Just fool around with your friends. Just hang out. And that's church. It's a breath of fresh air because they don't want an exhausting list of work because they're lazy. God said to work. He says, son, go work today in my vineyard. And what did one son say? I will not. And that's what Christianity today says when they're told, go work today in my vineyard. Go soul winning. Go do something. No, I don't want to. I'd rather go camping. I'd rather be outside. I'd rather hang out. So, of course, that's why people are eating this stuff up, because it's telling you, you don't have to work for the Lord. You don't have to actually show up to a church and listen to preaching. You just sit around and hang out and feel close to God by just being open with your relationships. Look at Acts chapter 20, verse 7, and I wonder how much the God of this book would have liked this church service. Acts chapter 20, verse 7, upon the first day of the week, when the disciples came together to break bread, Paul preached unto them, ready to depart on the morrow, and continued his speech until midnight. And there were many lights in the upper chamber where they were gathered together, and there sat in a window a certain young man named Eutychus, being fallen into a deep sleep. And as Paul was long preaching, he sunk down with sleep and fell down from the third loft and was taken up dead. And of course, it turns out he's not dead. He's fine. But they're preaching for hours and hours and just sitting and staring at the back of people's heads, you know, according to him. No, you're not here to stare at the back of people's heads. You're here to listen to a man of God, preach the Bible. Amen. Long preaching, hard preaching. But today's video game movie generation doesn't have the attention span to sit and listen to the Bible being preached. So it's like a breath of fresh air when they can just go see a movie instead and then just skip church, because that's just a man-made institution. You need to get free, bro. That's number 7 heresy of this book. You heard what I read for you. It's teaching that church is bad. We're the church, man. I'm the church. You're the church. Well, what about the elders of the church? Yeah. What about gathering the church together? What about long preaching? Where does that fit in? It doesn't. But number 8, not only does it teach that the church is bad, but number 8, it teaches us that we shouldn't be a Christian or try to make people a Christian. Now, this is bizarre, but listen to this. Is that what it means to be a Christian? It sounded kind of stupid as Max said it, but it was how he was trying to sum up everything in his mind. Jesus answers, who said anything about being a Christian? I'm not a Christian. That's what Jesus tells him in this book. I'm not a Christian. What did he talk about being a Christian? I'm not a Christian. Again, Jesus stopped. Those who love me have come from every system that exists. They were Buddhists or Mormons, Baptists or Muslims. They were Baptist. They were Buddhist. They were Mormon. They were Baptist. Or Muslims. Some are Democrats, some Republicans. Many don't vote or are not part of any Sunday morning or religious institutions. I have no desire to make them Christian, but I do want to join them in their transformation into sons and daughters of my papa, into my brothers and sisters, into my beloved. I mean, listen to this garbage. Just, oh, I don't want to make anybody a Christian. I'm not a Christian. You know, who said anything about being a Christian? Well, I know who did. The Bible did. God did. The real Jesus said something about being a Christian. Go to 1 Peter chapter 4. 1 Peter chapter number 4. Verse 16, of course, the Bible talks about in Acts chapter, I don't have the chapter in front of me, but in the book of Acts, how they were first called Christians at Antioch. That is a biblical term to be called a Christian. Agrippa, when he heard Paul's preaching, said, almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian. And you know what he said? You know what Paul said when Agrippa said to him, hey, almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian? Paul said, who said anything about being a Christian? Huh? I'm just looking for a relationship with you, buddy. I don't care if you're Buddhist or Baptist, man. No. Here's what he said. He said, I wish that you would altogether become a Christian. Not just almost, but altogether. Yep. And that you would be like me and follow me except for these bonds. Yep. But 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 16 says, yet if any man suffer as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God on this behalf. And this goes to show why they don't want to be called a Christian. Why? They don't want to go to church because they're lazy. They don't want to be told to work. They don't want to serve. They don't want to get exhausted. It's too tiring, right? They don't want to be a Christian because being a Christian involves suffering. If any man suffer as a Christian, that doesn't appeal to him. So he says, well, who said anything about being a Christian? Wants to skip that. Let me read for you some more excerpts here. Like I said, this is Jesus talking in the book. Like I said, I don't create institutions. That's an occupation for those who want to play God. So no, I'm not too big on religion. This is what Jesus is saying. So basically, anybody who creates an institution, like founding a local church, is playing God, according to him. So what about all the apostles who went around founding all these churches in the book of Acts and ordaining elders in every city? I guess they're playing God by doing that. He says, I'm not too big on religion. And this is something that you hear over and over again today where religion, and it's in this book a lot, that religion's bad. Where they say, you know, it's not a religion, it's a relationship. Religion's bad. But the Bible says, pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and the widows in their affliction and to keep himself unspotted from the world. That's why mainstream Christians today think that the word religion is bad. Why? Because they don't want to visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction. That's too much like work. And they don't want to keep themselves unspotted from the world. They want to live a worldly, carnal, sensual life. They don't want to go soul winning or visiting and reaching out to people. So that's why they don't want religion. They want relationship, which their version of relationship is navel gazing. It's not reading the Bible, praying, going to church, serving the Lord. It's just a navel gazing out in the woods Zen meditation that they call, you know, communing with the Holy Spirit, which is a fraud. But the real communing with the Holy Spirit is when we read our Bible and when we pray and when we sing praises to the Lord, not just out becoming one with the universe and nature like a Hindu or a Buddhist. So he says, I'm not too big on religion, not very fond of politics or economics either. Jesus' visage darkened noticeably. And why should I be? They're the man-created trinity of terrors that ravages the earth and deceives those that I care about. So Jesus is horrified by three things: religion, politics, and economics. Now, I can see why he's horrified by politics. So am I. We all are. But he's horrified by economics. Is this some communist thing now where making money is bad or business is bad? And, you know, again, it goes with the don't work, relax, sit around and commune with yourself. Mac, the world system is what it is. Institutions, systems, ideologies, and all the vain, futile efforts of humanity that go with them are everywhere, and interaction with all of it's unavoidable. But I can give you freedom to overcome any system of power in which you find yourself, be it religious, economic, social, or political. You'll grow in the freedom to be inside or outside all kinds of systems, and to move freely between and among them. Together, you and I can be in it and not of it. Mac responds, but so many of the people I care about seem to be both in it and of it. Mac was thinking of his friends, church people, who had expressed love to him and his family. He knew they loved Jesus, but he also knew they were sold out to religious activity and patriotism. Mac, I love them, and you wrongly judge many of them. For those who are both in it and of it, we must find ways to love them and serve them, don't you think? Asked Jesus. Remember, the people who know me are the ones who are free to live and love without any agenda. No agenda. We're not trying to make people convert to Christianity. We have no agenda. It's just about being. This is the kind of garbage that this book teaches. Let me move on. I gotta hurry through all this. Number nine, according to this book, the way that we hear from God is not by reading scripture, but rather it's by listening to ourselves. Listening to God speak through ourselves. And this book is just complete narcissism, start to finish. The guy who wrote this book is a moral narcissist who basically attributes his own beliefs and opinions to deity. That's who else would write a book where God's talking and just saying everything you believe? I mean, what if I wrote down all my beliefs and then I put them in a book where God is saying them all? No, the only thing that God said is this right here. Amen. And the Bible says, add thou not unto his words, lest he reprove thee and thou be found a liar. Right. We need to stop being so quick to just put words in God's mouth and realize that that is blasphemy. Mm-hmm. Go to John chapter 16. John chapter 16. According to this book, we hear from God by listening to ourselves, not scripture. But according to the Bible, the Holy Spirit speaks to us through the Word of God. The Holy Spirit uses the Word of God to speak to us. Listen to what this book says. And remember, in this wicked book, The Shack, and in the movie, the Holy Spirit is named Sarayu, which is a Sanskrit word. Sanskrit is the language of Hinduism. That's the only thing. It's a dead language. It's only used for Hinduism. And the name Sarayu is a Hindu goddess mentioned three times in the Hindu scriptures known as the Rig Veda. Okay? So that's who they're calling God in this book, a false god. But it's supposedly representing a bodily incarnation of the Holy Spirit, which is heresy in and of itself. Sarayu smiled. Mackenzie, you can always talk to me, and I will always be with you, whether you sense my presence or not. I know that now, but how will I hear you? You will learn to hear my thoughts in yours. Mackenzie, she reassured him. Do you hear what she's saying? Like, well, you'll hear my thoughts in yours. Because remember, the author of this book thinks that all his opinions are from the mouth of God. That's why he even wrote such a sick book. Will it be clear? This is what the protagonist answers. Will it be clear? What if I confuse you with another voice? What if I make mistakes? Yeah, you know what? That's what people do all the time. They confuse the voice of God with the voice of demons. These unsaved false teachers, they're hearing all kinds of voices. You know, I believe that they're hearing voices of the devil. But not only that, what most people are actually hearing is their own imagination. People have their own wild imagination, and then they say, oh, God told me this. God told me to do this. God gave me peace about this. And it's all just from their own figment of their imagination. Instead of being built on the rock, the Word of God, it just becomes this looking inward to the self and following our own imaginations. You'll learn to hear my thoughts and yours, Mackenzie, she reassured him. Will it be clear? What if I confuse you with another voice? What if I make mistakes? Now, at this point, she should tell him, hey, you need to check everything with the Bible. You know what I mean? Like, try the spirits, whether they're of God. Check it with the Bible. See if it lines up with Scripture, Mac. But here's what she says instead. Sarah, you laughed. Anytime the guy makes any sense, he's mocked and laughed at. Sarah, you laughed. The sound like tumbling water only set to music. Of course you'll make mistakes. Everybody makes mistakes. But you'll begin to better recognize my voice as we continue to grow our relationship. So it's okay to sometimes follow demonic voices or sometimes just follow your own carnal voice. You know, that's all right. Just kind of just go through it, make mistakes, just kind of just feel your way through it and just you figure out what you think is right or eventually you'll figure out when I'm talking to you. No reference to the Bible as being a final authority. Now let's look at the ministry of the Holy Spirit in Scripture. John chapter 16. This is a key passage in John 14, 15, and 16, where Jesus is teaching about the Holy Spirit and how after his resurrection, the Holy Spirit's going to indwell believers. He said, it's expedient for you that I should go away because he said, if I go away, I'll send the Comforter unto you. The Comforter, the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of truth. He will guide you into all truth. Look what it says in verse 13. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth, for he shall not speak of himself. Now, let me stop right there. The word of there, that does not mean about. It's not saying he's not going to speak about himself. Because the Holy Ghost does speak about himself, because if the Holy Ghost breathes Scripture and Scripture talks about the Holy Spirit, then that's the Holy Spirit talking about himself. But the word of there has to do with the source. Okay, it's sort of like when somebody said, I'm of Paul and I'm of Apollos. That's talking about an affiliation. Okay, and it's sort of like when you're speaking Spanish and you say, you know, you're from this place or from that place. It's the same as the word for of in Spanish, right? So the word of in English sometimes is referring to the source of something. So when it says he shall not speak of himself, what it's saying is he's not going to speak from himself, just stuff that he made up on his own. Okay, where he's the source. He shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak. And he will show you things to come. He shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine. Notice the word of there again. He shall receive of mine, which means from me. He's going to receive from the things which pertain to me, and shall show it unto you. All things that the Father hath are mine. Therefore said I that he shall take of mine and shall show it unto you. So he's not going to speak of himself, but he's going to speak of what he's given from me. That's what he's saying. Now, Jesus is the Word. Amen. The Bible says the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one. Jesus is the Word made flesh. The Holy Ghost does not speak of himself. He takes the Word of Jesus Christ and he shows it unto us. He'll take the things from Jesus and the Father and show it unto us, guide us into all truth. What does that mean? That means that the Holy Spirit is not going to come to you and say things that he came up with on his own that are not from Christ, that are not from the Word of God, that are not from the Bible, that are not from what's here. That's why the Bible calls the Bible, the Word of God, the sword of the Spirit. Think about that term, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Well, if I said the sword of Goliath, what do I mean by that? Again, talking about the word of. The sword of Goliath means what? It means Goliath's sword. So if we said the sword of the Spirit, we're saying the Spirit's sword. And it's even in the song, Standing on the Promises, overcoming daily by the Spirit's sword, standing on the promises of God. See, the Spirit's sword, is that the sword he uses? Or the sword we use. It's a Spirit's sword. See, he uses the Word of God in our lives. Now, of course, we use the Word of God as well. But he uses the Word of God. Otherwise, he wouldn't have a sword associated with him. If a guy never used the sword in his life, he wouldn't have a sword. The sword of Goliath, because Goliath is a guy who uses a sword. The sword of the Spirit, sure, we use it. We wield the Word of God as well. But so does he. That's why it's known as his sword, the sword of the Spirit. Why? Because the Spirit uses the Word of God. The Holy Spirit uses the Bible. He'll take of Christ's Word and show it unto us, illuminate it, and cast light upon it, and bring all things to remembrance. Jesus said that the Holy Ghost would bring all things to remembrance whatsoever Christ had spoken unto us. So, the more we read the Bible, memorize the Bible, and get God's Word in our heart, the more the Holy Spirit can bring verses into our mind. How many times have you been out soul winning, or those of you that have preached, or been in situations where you're talking to someone, witnessing, or talking about the Bible, and a perfect verse will just pop into your mind? That's often the Holy Spirit bringing those things to your remembrance. Or you're about to make a decision, and a verse pops into your mind that just cuts to your heart. And the Word of God directs you and leads you and guides you. That's the Holy Spirit working in your heart. Not this voice that just says,
go talk to him. Go talk to that guy over there.
No. What the Holy Spirit will do, he won't tell you.
Go talk to that guy over there.
What he'll tell you is go preach the gospel to every creature.
Yep.
And you'll see that guy, and the Holy Spirit will apply that to your heart. Hey, the Bible said to go preach the gospel to every creature. I've got an opportunity. This guy needs the Lord. I'm going to go preach the gospel. He'll use the Word of God. Here's the thing. If you don't read the Bible, and if you don't memorize the Bible, how's the Holy Spirit going to bring to remembrance stuff that you've never even heard? You can't remember that which you've never even read or heard. So the more you read, the more you learn, the more the Holy Spirit has to work with.
Amen.
In bringing things to your remembrance and guiding you into all truth. This is an extremely dangerous teaching that just says, just learn to hear the Holy Spirit's thoughts in your own thoughts. Because then you're just being led by yourself at that point. This is the rock, standing on the promises of God, overcoming daily by the Spirit's sword, not just following your heart and blindly groping through this life. Number 10, it says that this book teaches that the Bible does not teach us to follow rules. Listen to what it says. Mac allowed his paddle, because I think he's out canoeing with the Holy Spirit or something. But Mac allowed his paddle to turn in his hands as he let it play in the water's movements. It feels like living out of relationship, trusting and talking to you. It's a bit more complicated than just following rules. That's what Mac says. This is how God responds. What rules are those, Mackenzie? Do you like how God is just confused what rules he's even talking about? Like, this whole book is filled with rules. The Bible is filled with rules. And God just is constantly playing dumb. Like, what? Rules? What rules are those? All the things that the Scripture tells us we should do. Okay, she said with some hesitation. And what might those be? You can't even make this stuff up. Every time he makes sense, he's ridiculed, mocked, and scoffed at by this false god. Rules in the Bible? Really? You know, he answered sarcastically, you know, about doing good things, avoiding evil, being kind to the poor, reading your Bible, praying, going to church, things like that. I mean, I can see why this guy's getting a little frustrated in the book. Oh, I see. And how's that working for you? The Bible doesn't teach you to follow rules. It's a picture of Jesus. That's what this book says. Okay, what does the Bible say? How about this one? If you love me, keep my commandments. Because even if you're going to take this weird view that there's no rules in the New Testament or that the Old Testament was a bunch of rules, man, but in the New Testament we're just free in Christ, which is a false doctrine I'm going to deal with later in the sermon. But even if you took that view, Jesus said, if you love me, keep my suggestions. Is that what he said? No. He said, if you love me, keep my recommendations. He said, if you love me, keep my commandments. What's a commandment? It's a rule. If you love me, keep my commandments. McKinsey, religion's about having the right answers. And some of its answers are right. But I'm about the process that takes you to the living answer. And once you get to him, he'll change you from the inside. There are a lot of smart people who are able to say a lot of right things from their brains. Yeah, isn't that terrible? Because they've been told what the right answers are, but they don't know me at all. So really, how can their answers be right, even if they are right? Like, if we don't know this Hindu goddess, sorry you, then even when we're right, we're not really right. That's what it says. I mean, so really, how can their answers be right, even if they are right? If you understand my drift, she smiled at her pun. Well, I'm glad God is so pleased with herself in this book. So even though they might be right, they're still wrong. I understand what you're saying. I did that for years after seminary. I had the right answer sometimes, but I didn't know you. So will I see you again? He asked hesitantly. What is he, on a first date or something? So will I see you again? He asked hesitantly. Of course. You might see me in a piece of art. Or music. Or silence. What is silence? God is in the silence. Yeah, here we back to Hinduism and Buddhism again. Still our minds and hear God in the silence. I think I just lost my page here. Where was I? Oh, here we go. My ability to communicate is limitless. That's not what the Bible says. The Bible says the Holy Spirit will not speak of itself, will only take God's word and show it to us. But according to this, it's just the Holy Spirit can communicate in all these different ways. My ability to communicate is limitless, living and transforming, and it will always be turned to Papa's goodness and love. And let me just stop right there. I don't think it's right to call God Papa or Daddy or anything else. That's blasphemous, okay? The Bible gives us plenty of options. Father, Lord, God, Master. You know, pick something in the Bible, please. Just make up your own weird names. And you will hear, and you'll hear and see me in the Bible. Oh, thank you for throwing that in. And you hear and see me in the Bible in fresh ways. Just don't look for rules and principles. That's what it says. It says, yeah, you'll hear and see me in the Bible in fresh ways, but just don't look for rules and principles. Look for relationship, a way of coming to be with. A way of coming to be with. There's only one way. Jesus is the way. No man cometh unto the Father but by him. We don't just need to look for fresh ways to get there, but just ignore the principles and rules. Not only is the book saying to ignore the rules of God, it's also saying to ignore the principles that you would learn from the principles about right and wrong. Just no, that's going to mess you up. Ignore the rules, ignore the principles. Just look for fresh ways to come to be with us. And by the way, I don't even have this in my notes as one of the 17 heresies, but this just popped into my mind. I just remembered that actually in this book, Jesus says, I'm the best way for most people to relate to the Father. Instead, I'm a way. I'm a good way. He never says I'm the way. He's just a way. Let me move on here to the next. So just a quick review of where we're at tonight. Number 7, it teaches that church is bad, what we know as church. Number 8, it teaches us not to be a Christian or to make people a Christian. Number 9, it teaches that we hear from God by listening to ourselves, not Scripture. Number 10, it says that the Bible doesn't teach us to follow rules. Number 11, it says even if you're right, you're not right, unless you believe in Hindu doctrine. And number 12, it's teaching we don't have to obey any of God's laws. Turn, if you would, to Romans chapter number 6. We're going to go to Romans 6, and then we're going to go to 1 Corinthians chapter number 9. Romans 6 and then 1 Corinthians 9. While you're turning there, I'll read for you from this book here. Jesus laid the demand of the law to rest. It no longer has any power to accuse or command. Jesus is both the promise and its fulfillment. Are you saying I don't have to follow the rules? Mac had now completely stopped eating and was concentrating on the conversation. He's perplexed. Like, you're saying I don't have to follow any of the rules of the Bible? Yes. Yes, in Jesus, you're not under any law. All things are lawful. You can't be serious. You're messing with me again, moaned Mac. Child, said Papa, you ain't heard nothing yet. Is that why we like the law so much, to give us some control, asked Mac. Oh, it's much worse than that, resumed Sarayu. It grants you the power to judge others and feel superior to them. You believe you're living to a higher standard than those you judge. Enforcing rules, especially in more subtle expressions like responsibility and expectation, is a vain attempt to create certainty out of uncertainty. And contrary to what you might think, I have a great fondness for uncertainty. So according to this, God loves uncertainty. Not the rock, but the shifting sands. Rules cannot bring freedom. They only have the power to accuse. Whoa! Mac suddenly realized what Sarayu had said. Are you telling me that responsibility and expectation are just another form of rules that we're no longer under? Did I hear you right? Yup, Papa affirmed. Now we're in it. Sarayu, he's all yours. What, is he turning it over to some Hindu goddess? When we see each other or are apart, there's an expectancy of being together, of laughing and talking. That expectancy has no concrete definition. It's alive and dynamic, and everything that emerges from our being together is a unique gift shared by no one else. But what happens if I change the expectancy to an expectation? Spoken or unspoken, suddenly law has entered into our relationship. You are now expected to perform in a way that meets my expectations. Our living friendship rapidly deteriorates into a dead thing with rules and requirements. It's no longer about you and me, but about what friends are supposed to do or the responsibilities of a good friend. Or, noted Mac, the responsibilities of a husband or a father or an employee or whatever. I get the picture. I would rather live in expectancy. So here's what this is saying. Not only does God have no rules. Is everybody paying attention? Not only does God have no rules for us, according to this book, he doesn't even expect anything from us. We have no responsibilities in his sight, but that we're also supposed to carry that into our earthly relationships, meaning that I can't have any rules or expectations for my wife, and my wife doesn't have any responsibilities. He brought that up specifically, the husband and wife. And then he brings up the children. I don't have any expectations for my children. They don't have any responsibilities, and I don't have any rules for them. I mean, are you listening to this garbage? And you might say, well, that's not what he means. Oh, really? Because there's a whole movement out there of parenting like this. What's it called? Aha? Parenting? No, what's that aha thing? Don't get me off that. What is that? Aha Parenting? Isn't that a blog or something? Yeah, there's a blog or a website called Aha Parenting. And it's called positive parenting or attachment parenting and all these different movements out there that teach not only should you have no rules for your children, they literally teach this exact thing. You can't even, it's not even just don't punish them. It's don't have them, don't give them any consequence for doing wrong. Because they say, well, consequences, that's just another way of saying punishment. So not only do they not spank, are you listening? Not only do they not spank, they won't even have any consequence for the child doing wrong. The child can break things, hurt people, say anything, and there's no consequence. It's out there, and millions of people believe in it. And they're raising a generation of criminals and reprobates. Look, you can go online and look at these blogs and these Facebook groups and stuff. They have tens of thousands of likes saying, never spank your kids, don't even have rules, no consequences, no judgment, no punishment, and whatever. So that is what this book is saying, and it says it page after page after page. Now, let's see if this is really true, this doctrine that says, oh, well, Jesus came so that we're not under the law at all, and specifically the book said we're not under any law. There are no rules, scoffed at the rules, mocked him for even thinking that there were rules. What does the Bible say? Look at Romans chapter 6, verse 14. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for you're not under the law, but under grace. So this is the verse that a lot of these new evangelical Christian types will quote to say, we're free in Christ, we're not under the law, we're under grace. And their interpretation of this is that we don't have to obey the commandments of the Bible. Now, they're not talking about salvation. They're just saying we don't have to obey the commandments for any reason. So you'll try to show them, hey, wait a minute, are you sure you want to do that? Because the Bible said, thou shalt not. Whoa, buddy, you're trying to bring me back under bondage. We're free in Christ. I'm not under the law. I'm under grace. You know, you try to tell them, for example, don't get a tattoo. Thou shalt not print any marks upon your body. And they'll say, no, 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 you're trying to bring me under the law. I'm free in Christ, I can tattoo my body, I can fornicate, I can drink, I can do whatever, okay? It's out there, believe me. And those of you who've been in these liberal fun centers and been in these new evangelical churches, you've heard this kind of permissive attitude and permissive preaching, where we can't judge anything, just be led by the Spirit, and there's no rules, just do what you think Christ wants you to do. Even that's too much for this book. But anyway, look what it says in the next verse, though, just to make sure we don't misunderstand what it means to not be under the law but under grace. Verse 15 says, what then? Shall we sin because we're not under the law but under grace? God forbid. Now, what does it mean to sin? The Bible defines sin as the transgression of the law. Sin is the transgression of the law. So the Bible says here, because we're not under the law, should we transgress the law? No. So we are supposed to follow the rules. That's why Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. And that's why Jesus said, whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments and shall teach men so, the same shall be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. If you want to be called great in the kingdom of heaven, you will do and teach the rules. Amen. Do and teach the commandments of God. And that's out of the mouth of Jesus himself. In the New Testament. Go to 1 Corinthians chapter 6. I'm sorry, 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 19. I think you might already be there. It says, for though I be free from all men, yet have I made myself servant unto all that I might gain the more. And unto the Jews I became as a Jew that I might gain the Jews. To them that are under the law, as under the law, that I might gain them that are under the law. To them that are without law, as without law. Now stop right there. Paul is talking about becoming all things to all men. He's saying, hey, if I'm going to go and reach the Indians, I'm going to become like an Indian. If I'm going to reach the Mexicans, I'm going to become as a Mexican. If I'm going to go to reach the poor, I'll become as the poor. If I'm going to go to reach the Jews, I'll become as the Jews. He's saying, if I'm going to reach the Greeks, I'm going to be as the Greek. I've become all things to all men that I might by all means save some. He's just talking about the fact that he wants to reach people and that he wants to relate to them in a way that they can understand, right? So if you're gonna reach people of a certain culture, you can adapt certain things of that culture to reach them. You know, you don't want to just show up and just, well, I'm American, and not adapt to the culture of where you live. You know, if you go to a foreign country, you try to fit in. And this is what I try to do and what I try to encourage other people to do when we go on missions trips and so forth. We try to fit in. you know, when they ask us what we want to eat, we tell them, hey, let's eat the local food. And we try to eat the local food. We take showers in the black water instead of an Americanized shower. You know, we're sleeping out in the jungle and just trying to kind of fit in and be like the people, okay? But look what he says, because he's talking about going to those that are without law, going to the lawless. He said in verse 21, to them that are without law, as without law, but look what he's quick to add, being not without law to God, but under the law to Christ, that I might gain them that are without law. See, he didn't want us to misunderstand this doctrine and say, oh, well, if I'm going to reach the drunk, I got to go get drunk with them. Yeah. Hey, they're without law. Let's go become a criminal with them. To reach the criminal, I became as a criminal. No, no, no. He's saying that we do this without sinning, right? So if I go down to Guyana, okay, yeah, I'll eat the local food, I'll drink the soca soda, and I'll sleep out in the jungle or, you know, shower in black water. But if they're involved in a sinful practice, I'm not going to get involved in that. You know, if I'm going to go to India and try to reach Indians with the gospel, you know, I'm going to try to fit in with the culture, but I'm not going to bow down to a false god. Right. I'm not going to eat things sacrificed unto idols. I'm going to draw the line at breaking Christ's laws. Paul didn't say, well, I'm not under any law. He said, well, I became as one without law, but between me and God, I was under the law to Christ. Does everybody see that important distinction? It's pretty clear. It's crystal clear, isn't it? But not in this book. But can you see why people love this book? Of course you can see why people love it. Oh, I love this book. Because I heard somebody say, oh man, it just got rid of the last bit of legalism that I had left. It just set me free. Set you free to be carnal and worldly and wicked and skip church and be lazy and not do soul winning and not read your Bible and not listen to God's laws and not keep the commandments and not do any real work, to just do whatever you want, whatever your heart is telling you. And this is like a breath of fresh air for the wicked. The wicked love this book. And then they want us to apply this to our families and our even employees. Yeah, good luck running a business on the principles of this book. Hey, let's just all get in a circle and have a relationship, man. Yeah, that's going to be a real successful company real soon. I'm sure that business is going to thrive. Okay, so just to bring us up to speed here, we just talked about how, you know, you don't have to obey any of God's laws. We should have zero expectations for our wife, children, employees, etc. That was number 13. Number 14, go to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. I think you're in chapter 9, right? Go to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Number 14, heresy of the shack, is that it portrays God, the Father, as an old dude with a long gray ponytail. Okay. Now remember, in the beginning of the book, God the Father is portrayed as a large black woman, Aunt Jemima in the kitchen. Okay. But then later in the book, God appears to him one morning, and it's no longer the black woman anymore. Now all of a sudden, it's a dude in the book. In the book, it's a dude that looks like the black woman, but it's become a man though. But it's funny how the author just has to throw in with a long ponytail. Like, it just can't ever be a normal person. It can't just ever be a normal guy. It has to be with a long ponytail. Because of just the rebelliousness of the author to hate all things Christian, religious, or godly. I don't care who this offends. The Bible teaches that it is a sin for man to have long hair, period. End of story. And don't come at me with Jesus had long hair. That is a lie from the pit of hell. There is nothing in the Bible that talks about Jesus having long hair. Nothing. Only a bunch of paintings painted by a bunch of queer Renaissance painters, Leonardo, Raphael, Donatello, and the rest of the Ninja Turtles, okay, that basically painted all this stuff. Look, those paintings are not real. They're 1,500 years after Christ. 1,400 years after Christ. Jesus did not have long hair. Now look at 1 Corinthians 11. It says in verse 3, "But I would have you know that the head of every man is Christ, and the head of the woman is the man," watch this, "and the head of Christ is God." Another scripture, again, emphasizing the hierarchy in the Godhead, that the Son is subject unto the Father. The head of Christ is God. "Every man praying or prophesying, having his head covered, dishonoreth his head. But every woman that prayeth or prophesieth with her head uncovered, dishonoreth her head, for that is even all one as if she were shaven. For if the woman be not covered, let her also be shorn. But if it be a shame for a woman to be shorn or shaven, let her be covered. For a man indeed not to cover his head, for as much as he is the image and glory of God, but the woman is the glory of the man." Then he explains, what is this covering, the head uncovered versus uncovered? It's explained in verse 14. "Doth not even nature itself teach you that if a man have long hair, it is a shame unto him? But if a woman have long hair, it is a glory to her, for her hair is given her for a covering." So the covering here is long hair. If a man have long hair, it's a shame unto him. If a woman have long hair, it's a glory unto her. The Bible says that any man praying or prophesying, having his head covered, that is with long hair, dishonors his head. The head of every man is Christ. So if Christ prayed or prophesied having long hair, he would be dishonoring his head, God, the Father. If the woman prays or prophesies having short hair, uncovered head, she might as well get a butch hairdo. She might as well shave it all off, it says. But if it be a shame for her to be completely bald, let her also be covered, meaning having long hair. And it's saying here that if she doesn't, she's dishonoring her head, and the head of the woman is the man, so she's dishonoring who? Her husband. So if my wife has short hair, that's a shame unto me. If I have long hair, I'm a shame unto Christ. If Christ had long hair, which the Bible doesn't even mention as an option, because he never did, because he said, "I do always those things which please him." But theoretically, if he had long hair, he would be shaming the Father. Christ did not have long hair. And why is that, that the man should have short hair and the woman should have long hair? Well, the Bible says right here in verse 7, "A man indeed ought not to cover his head, for as much as he is the image and glory of God. But the woman is the glory of the man." It doesn't say, "and the woman is in the image of God also." It says, "but the woman is the glory of the man." Right. The man is made in the image of God because God is male. Amen. God is not female. God is male. Amen. So the man is in the image of God. Therefore, he has short hair like Jesus. Now, what sense would it make for the Bible to say, "Well, you need to have short hair, men, because you're in the image of God, and then when we meet God in the flesh, he has long hair"? That's crazy. It's madness. The Bible here says that it's a shame. And some people will say, "Well, it doesn't say it's a sin, it just says it's a shame." Well, but the Bible says the thought of foolishness is sin. And if the Bible says something is a shameful thing that dishonors Christ, and then you're going to say, "Well, it's not a sin, though," that's a foolish thought. The thought of foolishness is sin. You just sin by even saying that.
Yeah.
Saying such a dumb thing. But this right here is another great proof that God is distinctly male, and that this book portraying God as a female is perverted. But not only that, when it finally portrays God the Father as a male, which is still blasphemous, since God the Father never takes on bodily form, the Son is incarnate, he takes on the form of a guy with a ponytail. Let me go ahead and get on that page here in the book. "The man standing next to him looked a bit like Papa." This is the new manifestation, the new avatar of Papa. "The man standing next to him looked a bit like Papa, dignified, older, wiry, and taller than Mac. He had silver white hair pulled back into a ponytail." So he teaches at ASU. He teaches at the community college, right? Long-haired, gray ponytail, burned out hippie that he is. "Matched by a gray splashed mustache and goatee, plaid shirt with sleeves rolled up, jeans and hiking boots completed the outfit of someone ready to hit the trail." "Papa?" Mac asked. "Yes, son." Mac shook his head. You're still messing with me, aren't you? Yeah, that's because this whole book is just messing with your mind.
Yeah.
From start to finish. Always, he said with a warm smile. Yeah, that's all God does. He just messes with us. Just screws with our mind. Appearing to us as all these different Chinese woman, black woman, burned out hippie, just coming at, we're just, gives us a book full of rules and then acts like we're an idiot when we talk about following them. Excuse me? Rules? What? What rules? This morning you're gonna need a father. Come on now, let's get going. So that's why he's manifesting as a dude finally. And the last thing is this, actually the last three things, but they all kind of go together. Okay, and I'm running out of time anyway, but you know, this book has already blasphemed God in every possible way. It's depicted God in so many, it's just turned scripture on its head over and over again. But finally, we get to the point of the whole book. You say, what's the book even about? Because I didn't even really mention what the book's about this morning. Because remember how it's supposedly a work of fiction? Well, the storyline, remember how I said when you read the first 80 pages, you feel like you're reading a normal book? It just seems like a murder mystery or a kidnapping mystery. And you know, it just seems like a totally normal book. I kind of got into the story. I was enjoying the first 80 pages. And then it just like gets into all this weird theology and philosophy and garbage. But here's what the story is about. This guy's daughter gets kidnapped in the first 80 pages. That's what it's about. Family man, and he leaves his kid unattended because he's busy with something else, and it was just not his fault. But the kid gets kidnapped, and they're freaking out because the six-year-old girl was kidnapped by a predator. I mean, by a serial you know what. I'm not even going to go into it for sake of children, but just imagine the most horrific things that people do to little girls. This guy is a serial whatever, and he has abducted the six-year-old girl because he left some marks at the scene of the crime where they know that this guy is the one who has taken his daughter. And they tell him, look, you know, this guy's victims don't survive, and you're doomed. Well, the book takes place 4 years after that event. And remember, this whole book is about this guy, Mac, hanging out at the shack with God, which is manifesting in these bodily manifestations as the Trinity being a black woman, a Jewish guy, and a Chinese woman. But the whole point of why he's going back and forth with God, why he's having all these conversations we've been looking at this morning and tonight, page after page, the whole point is that God in this book is trying to get him to forgive the guy who just brutally did these horrible things to his daughter. And God's trying to explain to him how he loves this guy and how this guy is one of his children. Okay, according to this book. But this man, Mac says, but he too is my son. I want to redeem him. So this book teaches that not only are unsaved people children of God, even the most violent pedophile predator is a child of God, according to the Bible. No, the Bible says as many as received him. To them gave he power to become the sons of God, meaning they were not previously sons of God. So what then? I just forgive him and everything's okay? And we become buddies? Max stated softly but bitterly. You don't have a relationship with this man, at least not yet. Forgiveness does not establish relationship. In Jesus, I have forgiven all humans for their sins against me, but only some choose relationship. Did you hear that? So according to this book, God has forgiven all people, whether they're saved or not. This is the last scripture we're going to turn to, Acts chapter 26. Acts chapter 26. According to this book, God has just forgiven everybody. And remember, we looked at the points in the book this morning where God said nobody's going to hell and that everybody is going to be forgiven. So he said, well, I've already forgiven all humans for their sins against me, but only some choose relationship. Let's see if that's true. Acts chapter 26, verse 17. Delivering thee from the people and from the Gentiles unto whom now I send thee, to open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me." According to the Bible, you have to have faith in Christ. You have to receive the forgiveness of sins by being turned from darkness to light, from the power of Satan to the power of God, that you might receive forgiveness of sins. You have to believe in Christ. We have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, but everyone is not automatically forgiven. You must believe on the Lord Jesus Christ to be saved. This book teaches everybody's forgiven, even pedophiles, rapists. Everybody's already been forgiven. You know, whether or not they choose relationship with Jesus is a moot point. They're still forgiven according to this. Listen to this, though. This is just mind-blowing. And another scripture on that same point, Romans 4 says, "Blessed is the man whose iniquities are forgiven and whose sins are covered." Blessed is the man to whom the Lord will not impute sin. That's not everybody. You're blessed if you're one of those whose sins are forgiven, whose iniquities are covered. You know, I mean, we could show a lot of scripture on that. Just wait till you hear this, though. This is the worst, okay? "Forgiveness in no way requires you to trust the one that you forgive. But should he finally confess and repent, you will discover a miracle in your own heart that allows you to reach out and begin to build between you a bridge of reconciliation. And sometimes, and this may seem incomprehensible to you right now, that road may even take you to the miracle of fully restored trust." Okay, stop. Just stop. This book is saying that this serial child rapist, you know, you don't have to have a relationship with him right away. He's already forgiven by God. Now we're supposed to forgive him. And then not only that, we're supposed to start building a relationship with the guy, and eventually the goal is fully restored trust. Because the guy just finished bringing up, "Well, am I supposed to let this guy hang around with my other kids?" Well, you know, you'll be shocked at the miracle of my grace that'll bring a fully restored trust. I mean, that part I almost felt like I was reading Born That Way After All again. You know what I mean? Right? Those of you that were here several weeks ago when I preached that sermon, that, you know, that is what it reminded me of, like fully trusting pedophiles and sodomites. Let me just close by saying this. The guy who wrote this book is a reprobate. The guy who wrote this book hates God. How do I know that? Because anyone who writes a book describing God 180 degrees different than what the Bible describes him, he must not like the God of the Bible. He didn't even want to retain that God in his knowledge. He'd rather make up his own false God because he hates the true God. And as I said this morning, I'll say it again. Anyone who loves this book does not love God. Because how can you love the real God and the fake God? That'd be like me saying, "Oh, I love my wife so much," and then I'm just spending all this time with another woman and saying that she's better. You'd say, "You don't love your wife at all. You're with some other woman. You've gone a whoring." And that's what I talked about this morning. I'm not going to re-preach that. But this guy is a reprobate. Now, how did this guy become a reprobate? Well, this guy is the son of missionaries, it says on the back, in Papua New Guinea. He was raised amongst a Stone Age tribe of cannibals in Papua New Guinea who began to abuse him and molest him starting when he was 6 years old. So from 6 years old, this guy is molested and abused by cannibals, literal cannibals, in Papua New Guinea, which is one of the most primitive countries in the entire planet. Then from there, he's shipped off to a missionary boarding school where he's further molested and further abused. This guy's just his whole life just being molested. And he's from a mission. Obviously, this guy, because that stuff's happening to him from such a young age, got bitter against God. I mean, you can see how a child who grows up being abused constantly their whole life and being perverted by freaks and savages and cannibals and weirdos is going to grow up and hate the Lord because he's going to become bitter against God. Now, we are not supposed to have pity for these people. And see, you might think, oh, well, the poor guy, it's not his fault. I mean, he's raised by cannibals after all. But you know what? It doesn't matter. Nothing that happens to you in your life gives you the right to become a God-hating reprobate yourself and to become a predator yourself. You know, and all of these sodomites, listen to me. All these sodomites, when you talk to them, they've all been molested as a kid. Virtually. I mean, I'm not saying all of them, but I'm saying virtually all of them. Most of them. The vast majority. But does that give them an excuse to become a reprobate, to hate the Lord, and to do these wicked things themselves? No. Because guess what? There were a lot of other people who were molested who didn't hate God. Who actually grew up and lived right. And instead of hating God, they, you know, I find this about people who've been molested. They usually either grow up either hating pedophiles or hating God. Because I've met a lot of people who say, yeah, I was molested as a kid, and they hate pedophiles. And they say, put them to death.
Amen.
But then you'll run into others who hate God, and they blame God for what sinful man has done to them and what his wicked parents subjected him to. I mean, what kind of parents took him to this filthy place and just led him amongst these cannibals? A bunch of idiots. What kind of missions is that? Canadian and raised amongst a Stone Age tribe by his missionary parents in the highlands of New Guinea and blah, blah, blah. So the thing about this book is that it's written by a reprobate who obviously hates God. He's obviously perverted in his mind, and he wants to teach this doctrine that we're supposed to embrace pedophiles and trust them and love them. No, the Bible says that I hate those that hate the Lord. Do not I hate them that hate thee? Am not I grieved with those that rise up against thee? I hate them with a perfect hatred. I count them my enemies. That's what the Bible says. But see, Oprah Winfrey doesn't want to hear that. 20 million readers of The Shack don't want to hear that. They teach the doctrine that God loves everybody and that we're supposed to love everybody, a doctrine that's not found in Scripture at all. Yes, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. But when people reject that gift, when they reject God, and they don't even want to retain God in their knowledge, God will give them over to a reprobate mind to do those things that are not convenient. And let me tell you something, when God gives them over to vile affections, and God gives them over to a reprobate mind, the Bible says, I will love them no more. He said, I hated them, and I will love them no more. The Bible says that God hates all the workers of iniquity. The Bible says that God hates those who love violence. So this teaching that God loves everybody. No, God loved everybody at some point until they push God too far and become a reprobate. And then God said, I'll love them no more, which means he previously loved them, but they loves them no more. So this doctrine that we're being taught on all fronts today, church, movies, books, is to embrace, it all is an agenda to embrace sodomites and embrace pedophiles. That's what it all goes back to, that agenda to bring in the worst perversion, to replace the God of the Bible, the God of wrath and of judgment, with a God who's only love, only sweetness and light, and who embraces all manner of perverts, brings them into the church, and trusts them with children. It's sick. And there's no excuse for anybody who's promoting this. Any preacher who's promoting this book needs to repent and get right with God.
Right.
There's no excuse that it's fiction. It's not fiction. It's theology and philosophy. It should be in the doctrine section of the bookstore. And, you know, you say, well, but Ken Hovind, you know. Ken Hovind said he read the book 9 times. You can't say, oh, he doesn't know. He read it 9 times. Yeah. And look, I can't even believe the stuff that's been coming out of Ken Hovind's mouth lately. And to hear about this book that he's promoting and all the weird stuff he's teaching. And sometimes I'm just shocked and horrified and wondering, like, what in the world is going on with this guy? But then you'll go back and listen to his stuff from before he went into prison. And he sounds good. So I'm not saying that he's not saved, because maybe prison just really screwed him up. I mean, man is not really meant to be locked up in a cage for 9 years. I mean, maybe prison just screwed him up. I don't know what happened to him in there. I don't know what kind of influences. But, you know, if I had to guess, And again, I'm just throwing, and you say, you're being disrespectful to him. Well, you know what? If he's going to promote this new age filth, then he needs to be called out. A book that makes God a woman. I mean, I'm not going to re-preach the 17 points of this morning and the evening. But, you know, he's opening himself up. And look, by making this speculation, I'm giving him the benefit of the doubt that he's not just evil. I'll make this speculation to give him the benefit of the doubt that maybe it's just because when he was in jail, every single day he went to an ecumenical church service every day in jail. Because that's what he told me. He said that he was in every single day, they had like an ecumenical church service with some chaplain where he's worshiping together with all the Pentecostals and all the different denominations all coming together into an ecumenical church service in the prison for like 9 years. Well, you know what? That just goes to show you then, if he was a righteous preacher before he went in, which it seems like he was. I mean, he preached a lot of good sermons and a lot of good stuff. That just shows you how hanging around with the wrong people could really corrupt you bad. Yeah. Because spending 9 years in there, you know, he's probably just lonely, so he's just looking for any fellowship. So he starts fellowshipping with the charismatics and all the false teachers, and that they got to him. Because this isn't the same Kent Hovind. And look, there's no excuse for this. I mean, this is bad, really bad. And so, you know, the answer for Kent Hovind is that he needs to repent. Kent Hovind needs to repent and say, and every one of his followers should demand this of him. They should demand of him and say, you know what? You need to repent of following the shack and promoting the shack. Because he just keeps digging in. People try to bring it up to him, and here's what he says. I'm still promoting it to this day, and you can quote me on that, that I recommend this book. It's one of the best books I've ever read. Well, you know what? He needs to come out and say, I'm sorry, I was wrong. And you know what? Other preachers have done the same thing. I've heard of other preachers who, you know, they got onto a wrong Bible version, and then after a couple months, they realized the error of their ways and said, hey, I'm sorry I recommended this Bible version. I was wrong. We need to stay with the King James. Amen. Amen. You know, it's great when people get right with God, but you cannot just overlook this and say, oh, well, you know, he's still a great preacher. Whoa. This is evil, new age garbage. And for him to promote this, that shows that his heart is not right with God. And that he is leading people astray, because he's talking about all the emails he gets from people whose lives have been changed by the book after he recommended it to them. Well, you know what? It wasn't changed for the better. It was changed for the worse. I promise you that. Because now they're walking with a figment of their imagination instead of the God of the Bible. We are living in the last days. And we need to be on our guard, because even independent fundamental Baptists are getting sucked in by this stuff. Even, I mean, look, you know, we were just talking about this afternoon how so many independent Baptists now they're leaning new evangelical now. Like when like back in the 90s, the way the new evangelicals were back then is how the independent fundamental Baptists are now. And the way Faithful Word Baptist Church is right now is how the independent fundamental Baptists were in the 90s. So basically, Faithful Word style churches and our friends and people that we fellowship with are becoming the new actual fundamental Baptist movement in this country. And then the old independent fundamental Baptist movement is becoming the new evangelical movement of the 90s, where it's just this sloppy agape, love everybody, just this bring in the homos, bring in the pedophiles, let's all go see the shack and embrace this stuff. Let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Father, thank you so much for the rock of our salvation. Thank you that you're not a God who loves uncertainty, but that you founded us on a rock, the unchanging word of God, Lord. Help us to love you with all our heart, mind, and soul, and strength, and not to go whoring after other gods and seek after other gods that teach things and believe things and promote things other than what the Bible teaches, Lord. Help us to stay with the God of the Bible and the Holy Ghost of the Bible, not the Hindu goddess Sarayu that tens of millions of American Christians have apostatized and gone a whoring after, Lord. Help us not to go a whoring after that false god or any false figment of our imagination, Lord. Cast down every imagination that enters our mind that's contrary to the knowledge of you. and of the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.